I think I'll stay put because there's shortage of chairs.
I thank the organizers for giving me this particular opportunity. What I'm going to share here is part of a larger narrative. I'm going to keep, in order to keep it short, I'm just building this little narrative around one particular case study. I'm going to go very quickly over definitional kind of understandings. I'm not going to be talking about definitional stuff here, but maybe later in the question answer sessions. Now, I'm trying to build an argument for gender justice around issues which I'm not going to take up legal kind of understandings around or definitional. What I'm trying to say here is that I want to look at justice from the point of view about how it makes a difference to the people who really want justice. And here I'm looking at gender and looking at the intersectionality of age also. I mean, age is also an intersectionality, looking at the most vulnerable, that is the girl child. And I say that justice is hard, it demands our devotion as well as our understanding. For that reason, it must grip our emotions. We must feel its presence and absence with the depth of feeling that we associate with love. This is Joshua Cohen on Martha Nussbaum's latest book, Political Emotion, Why Love Matters in Justice. Now, this is a cover of The Economist. It says, gendercide, whatever happened to 100 million baby girls? This is a global perspective on the declining child sex ratio in India, referring to the number of girls who are missing in the Indian population due to the misuse of reproductive technologies and because of daughter aversion. I want to keep this particular page in mind as the cover, because this is only talking about the girls, rather than looking at it in a term, in an understanding which is a continuum. You're not just looking at girls, you're looking at young women who are disappearing, you're looking at women who are disappearing. It's almost the disconnect between the girl and the women is something that nearly needs to be looked at. This is the sex ratio of the world, and India here is on the 16th. This is adult sex ratio. We're looking at 943, and I leave you with that slide for some time. I'm not going into details. This is the declining child sex ratio, and I have taken the title there, Little Girls and Death. So this is from Pranabardhan's writing in the 1970s. And then it talks about little girls and death, not about the larger continuum, which is to understand it as linking it with gender justice. At present in India, we have 919 girls in the 0 to 6 age group, which means that we are looking at a decline which is the lowest in the category from 1961 to 2011. And this is now spread all over India. It is no longer the urban, prosperous, culturally intensified daughter aversion centers. It's now gone everywhere, and that's something that we really need to note here. Now, I'm going to look at competing discourses of the state and the global and see where they kind of overlap and where they are disagreeing from each other. And the state and the global discourse on this has taken various issues around this. One is that demographic, that actually there are a number of women who are disappearing, 100 million missing women, Amartya Sen said that. But I think that's something that's really engaged the state and the global discourse on this. Then there is economic, which means that women's worth is actually not so much in that particular society, and because they do not have an economic worth, that is why they are being dealt with in the manner that they are being dispensed. So you're looking at them more as liabilities than as assets, linking it up with cultural kind of context of dowry and the rest of it. Then criminal, that there is a technology which is being misused, and that particular technology is meant to save lives, but in a cultural context it is being used to misuse and then to get rid of women. And then there is of course ethics, which always emerges when there is a state and a global discourse, that you're looking at a human rights situation. But nowhere does it really engage with the notions of gender that really talks about women's rights from the perspective of justice in terms of the intersectionalities that I think both the presentations here have talked about. Now, in the policy response continuum, you have a law which is called the PCPNDT Act, which is about misuse of technology. And on the, that's basically the supply side. The demand side, I think the understanding is around gender discrimination, that this is gender discrimination that needs to be controlled by the state through various initiatives. And one of the main initiatives there is a financial incentive scheme, which again emerges from a global kind of a perspective. One, this is my case study. It goes around conditional cash transfers. Conditional cash transfers have been regarded worldwide as the latest silver bullet to fight poverty and social inequality. It's a World Bank kind of an initiative, and it is based on the positive evaluation of Latin American experiences, Bolsa Familia in Brazil and Progresa in Mexico and the others. The main thing is that there is a short-term kind of a context here, cash transfer for immediate poverty alleviation, and a long-term which is boosting human and social capital. So here it is felt that if you pay a family a certain amount of money so that they can bring up their daughters, they will then be able to love their daughters more. So here you do have the origin and evaluation of a particular conditional cash transfer, the Ladli scheme, which I have worked on. Ladli means loving your daughters. But I'll just run you through a few slides to tell you how this finally, you know, how it's operationalized in the field. If you're going to look at the various schemes that exist, Dharalakshmi, which is really emerging from the government of India, but the rest, the Bali Rakshak Yojana, the Ladli scheme, almost all of them do talk about the girl child, but they link it up with coercive population policies, which is about controlling the number of people in the family. So therefore, there is never an overarching gender understanding about women's rights or about rights of reproduction, which emerges from a feminist discourse or from a rights-based discourse. So you do have a certain number, and I can probably do this, leave this slide with you in the way I can, but these are the various schemes, and almost all of them have certain kind of clauses, criteria, which goes against women's rights. Studies also have shown, Srinivasan and Vedi and Sundarajan and others have looked at these girl child protection schemes, and they have said that they are definitely ineffectual, and they do not tend to really improve the status of girls or of women. I mean, the disconnect is very clear here. You're not only talking about little girls. So you're looking at women, and you are getting rid of women from the population. So that is something that they have not been able to deal with. And then, of course, the studies that I have done around the Ladli scheme, I have tried to look at whether it has actually brought about a turnaround in declining child sex ratio, and then whether it enhances daughters' worth, whether there is aspirations for education, or it is, you know, countering marriage, because that is one of the kind of criteria that is there, that is able to counter child marriage. And who gets left out? And if you're looking at Dalits or you're looking at others, how do they get left out from this? And of course, there is, of course, bureaucratic red tapism and the rest of it. The turnaround in sex ratio, that's a premature celebration, and it's definitely not happened. There's never been a turnaround in sex ratio because of a girl-child scheme, and that nearly needs to be understood. And then another thing is, can money buy me love? That's another understanding that we need to work around, and whatever studies have been done, and even my own study shows that it definitely does not. There are times when the girl-child may be welcomed because there is something there, but the idea is that it reinforces the stereotype that she is definitely a liability. And this is something that John Rees, the famous economist, also questions the wisdom of bribing parents to keep their daughters. The other thing that I have looked at very closely is whether it actually leads to aspirations for better career and all of that, or does it lead to marriage? In fact, my study very clearly shows me that it does lead to enhanced understandings around wanting to get married, how to get married, how to spend on the weddings, and in fact, studies even by Sabujas and others say that that incentive money is itself used for dowry. So there is an understanding here that emerges that the market has never been questioned, and the reproductive technologies have been left out, and the ideas around marriage is what has really emerged. So the young women do not have any other role models to look at, so the imagination is being captured by this idea of marriage, and they even want to spend it on a wedding lehenga, which is the wedding dress, rather than spend it on an education, because there's no way they can link up their own understandings of what they want to do, because there are no career opportunities, there is no linking of that. So, and it stops at one or two daughters, and I think Thomas Pogge, we were discussing that it compounds the vulnerability of the excluded in both economic as well as psychosocial terms, because it says only to two daughters, not to the third. The most vulnerable and the most deserving are then left out, and there's this whole idea of certification which needs to be looked at. I'm running through these slides. Now, I'm bringing up what I see as an understanding that needs to be looked at. What is it? You have a global discourse here, looking at from a World Bank perspective, looking at conditional cash transfers. You have a state discourse here, again looking at women almost as if they are to be targeted, mainly in terms of, you know, controlling their reproduction. So there is really nothing here coming up about gender justice. It's not something that has even engaged their minds. So what is it that we need to do here? I then, therefore, this is my submission, but I'm looking at a syncretic feminist perspective emerging both from the global and the local fields, and then looking at inclusion and reconceptualization, taking into account class, caste, region, religion, age, and gender. All of it, I think, needs to come together when you look at issues like this. And here I bring you another policy pathway which is connected to the dots, which is coming from the UNFPA, which looks at reproductive rights, but it is informed both by global and local stories. And it is not just looking at feminist groups and women's movements, vibrant as they are, but looking beyond that to academia and looking at local groups, and then informing their understanding around how to counter gender discrimination and enable gender justice. And they are looking at what they call the three A's: assets, with girls, women, where they earn, they own, they inherit, where you're looking at land rights, you're looking at property rights, and the rest of it. Autonomy, how do you enhance that? Looking at ability, power, choices, physical safety, mobility, laws, all of that, and aging. how to bring about social protection for women, because one of the larger reasons why girls are missing is because they are not going to be taking care of their parents, and then therefore if you, and South Korea and others have shown that social security does manage to enhance the kind of, the declining child sex ratio has improved in South Korea. So social security also becomes one of the reasons. So within the syncretic feminist perspective, I borrow from Nussbaum, and I borrow very liberally. I don't stand on any sides, because I think it's very important that we borrow from all of them. There's Nussbaum, there's Naila Kabir, there's whoever else you want. Citizenship, I'm looking at dialogic citizenship, and Neera Yuval Davis and Nina Webner, looking at transversal practices and mainstreaming social protection within broader developmental efforts. What are the ways that we can actually do that, and things that you talked in the last two, I think, sessions? Intersectionality, keeping in mind gender specific constraints, gender intensified inequalities, something that Professor Patel has always been talking about, and the imposed forms of gender disadvantages. What are they? That, you know, every time that's changing. Right now, if you're looking at gender disadvantages, you're also looking at sexuality. You can't really keep it out of the box, because you need to look at that. What happens when the same-sex couple wants to adopt, and how does then, you know, how do you rework on that? And I think I'll leave that with commercial surrogacy, because even that open-endedness needs to be there. So those are issues that I want to. And I think, of course, we can't abandon a scheme. And I'm only talking about this scheme, a conditional cash transfer, the only commitment that the government of India has made in the name of the girl child, even if it's World Bank aided and we have problems ideologically with that. But we need to go forward rather than backwards. Social protection schemes need to accommodate a more proactive role of the state. I think feminists have always said that we need to look at the state in reformist ways, in collaborationist ways, in confrontationist ways. We can't let go of the state. We need to keep it in, because you can't question the market. The state can also be a site for struggles. And I think over the interpretation of needs and the allocation of revenues. Building the capacity of the marginalized and excluded groups. I mean, if this young woman knew what she wanted to do, if she knew somebody, there could be skill development and what career she wants to. So building that capacity to participate in these struggles is indispensable to the promotion of more inclusive systems of social protection and to the achievement of gender justice. Thank you.